Amazing. All right, I think we're going to get started. Thank you all for coming out. This is our visit day, so we're really excited to have a bunch of new faces in the room. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Gillian Smith. Gillian is an assistant professor at Northeastern University who has recently announced that she is moving to Worcester Polytechnic. So she's about to have an exciting career change, which is very exciting. Gillian did her PhD at UC Santa Cruz, working with Jim Whitehead, Michael Mateus, and
Noah.
Noah, Roger Froon. She is a designer, she is a scholar, she is a theorist. Her work covers topics such as procedural content generation in games, computational craft, textiles and play, and games and education. There are pictures of several of her pieces up here that she'll be talking about, including Threadsteading in the middle, which won the Most Innovative Tabletop Game Award at the Boston Festival for Innovative
Games. Threadsteading's Technology Award.
Threadsteading's Technology Award. And then eBee is the most innovative game, Indiecade, right?
Or you're close.
I'm close.
We'll get there.
She's an award-winning game designer is really where I'm going. Clearly I shouldn't have written this down. I'm very happy that you're here. I'm looking forward to what she has to say. So yeah, please give her a warm welcome.
So it's really a pleasure to be out here in Irvine. You guys have a fantastic program, and it's been great learning about it. Also, the weather here is like significantly nicer than in Boston right now. So I will take any excuse to come to California in the middle of winter. As Josh said, I'm currently an assistant professor at Northeastern University. I'm there in the Department of Art and Design, and also in Computer Science. And I'll be moving to WPI in the fall, where I'll be in computer science and interactive media and game development. And I say this not to brag, but to try to set the stage for the fact that my background is like really weird. And Josh and I were actually having a conversation about this earlier, like what do we call the type of work that people like us do, right? Is it interdisciplinary? Is it transdisciplinary? Multidisciplinary? Postdisciplinary? Antidisciplinary? something is clearly happening that doesn't like purely fit into one of the core disciplines. And so that's the kind of person I am. I do have a formal background in computer science. My work typically fits into either artificial intelligence or HCI or sometimes both. But I have forever, since I was a very little girl, had an interest in things far beyond like the formal mathematical, scientific world. So some of my other interests that I try to incorporate into my work are things around fiber arts or jewelry. I'm interested in history and language. I'm interested in why we play and what we play and how we can make new kinds of play. I'm interested in music. So I've kind of, instead of saying like, hi, I'm a computer scientist or whatever, I've taken to kind of being like, this is the word cloud that describes who I feel like I am today. Where if any of these like terms resonate with you and you feel like I'm not addressing them in my talk, I'm more than happy to talk with you about them later. So I'm very interested in like stuff that intersects this kind of playful feminist spatial space. So I do work in games. My PhD was, as Josh said, in computer science and procedural content generation for games. But recently I've been moving into craft. And I want to talk first a little bit about why I'm interested in craft and why I think it's something that you all should be interested in as well. And then how I feel like it intersects with games and computation. So I'm interested in craft for a lot of reasons. I feel like as we move more and more into like virtual worlds, I crave more and more tangible things that I can like touch and feel and sense without needing to like imagine that I'm in some different space. So I like craft's properties of being tangible and tactile. I try to really deeply respect that craft is rooted in many cases, millennia-old traditions, right? People have been passing down traditions of how we do craft, whether it's sewing and embroidery or ceramics or mosaics, right? Like all of these crafts have been passed down for generations. They're some of the oldest technologies that we have, right? Are rooted in how we craft things that we use in the world. So I'm fascinated by that, especially as it gets juxtaposed with computation, which we like to think of as something new. craft, especially textile arts, is seen as a very feminine practice, and often people co-opt it to be a feminist practice, right? A way of expressing feminist ideals, a way of bringing women together where they can talk about sort of social events and things that are going on in their space, sort of couched in the safety of the fact that they're just like sewing things, right? So it doesn't seem threatening. I already said craft is something that's inherently intergenerational, right? These practices are often passed down from grandmother to daughter. I learned how to sew from my mother, who in turn learned how to sew from her mother, right? And it's something that feels really rooted in family and love, right? Craft is something that lets us tell stories in interesting ways. And craft is, to me, and maybe this is sort of the bit that ties back into where I came from in procedural content generation, is craft really highlights the importance of aesthetics, right? Like you can make a quilt or you can make an embroidery and it may serve function, but sort of equally important to that function is the story it tells or the colors that were chosen that have meaning to a family or... So the visual aesthetics are really, really important here, right? And I think that's something that's interesting to try to capture, especially in generative design spaces where typically we focus much more heavily on structure and try hard not to quantify what beauty means, right, or what aesthetics means. And I'm interested in that sort of juxtaposition. When it comes to trying to bridge craft and games, I tend to see craft as a type of play. Right, and we see this with children's toys, like little button art type things that, you know, our kids play with when they learn how to do craft. And I think there's sometimes a tendency sort of in informal spaces to think about craft as the domain of children, right? But craft is a form of play that our children do, but also a form of play that adults do, right? These are two quilts from a quilt show, I think this is 2 years ago now, that are like examples of a new movement within craft and within quilting called modern quilting. This bringing people together around designing quilts that sort of look different and look less traditional but still build on traditional techniques for making them. And people will talk about their craft as though they are playing, right? They're playing with colors, they're playing with design elements, they're playing like socially when they're sharing ideas with other people and sharing pieces with other people. So I like to think of craft as a form of play. I also think craft is interesting when held next to sort of, I think, the more famous, potentially, movement of making, right? Where craft... does anyone actually remember Craft magazine? I assume most people remember Make or have seen Make magazine at some point in this department, maybe. Craft magazine, when did it get canned, Josh?
It was, like, it only lasted like 2 years.
Yeah, it was a very short-lived experiment, but it came from the same people who were doing Make magazine. And it was like making for women, right? And it's all about, you know, like making cakes and sewing snakes and sort of trying to repurpose the traditions of craft, like reusing old materials, coming up with new kinds of projects that you can do. But it was positioned as being separate from making, where really these are two practices that share a lot of common themes. And a lot of common skills. Like, you need to be really good at math to make quilts. But you may not realize that you're really good at math when you're doing it. But people will need to solve, like, complex geometric optimization problems, figuring out, like, how do I minimize the amount of fabric that I want to use and lay out all the pieces that I need to cut out of it so that there's not much waste and so that I'm not buying more fabric than I need to. And you're like, well, you know, if I put these rectangles here and then, like, slide some squares next to them, like, I can figure out a way to do this, like, with minimum waste. And, you know, I'll see women at quilting groups talking about doing this and how they, like, spend a bunch of time really trying to figure out how to do it, and then turn around and say, you know, my daughter came home with her algebra homework last night and I just don't know how to help her with it. Which to me is, like, absurd on some level, right, because they're doing something far more complicated than that, but not realizing they're doing it. So I'm interested in, like, the way we talk about making and the way we talk about crafting and how that relates to gender, and how that relates to the skills that that we think we need to have to be able to perform in these spaces, right? And I think craft is an interesting way of being able to take the maker movement and like put a more feminine spin on it, and then be able to say that like really crafting isn't that different from making. The other area that I think craft becomes interesting to me is its relationship to computation. And this is something that Josh and I have been talking a lot about in recent years. Where, so this is, oh, the image is a little dim, but do these lights need to be on, actually?
You could probably do something about
it. For that. This, it doesn't matter, but for later pictures, it might matter. Josh is going to figure it out. So this, like, oddly pixely image right now, this is a jacquard loom. Have any of you heard of a jacquard loom before? I'm seeing some nods, some hands. So the jacquard loom is the first programmable machine. And it weaves things. Like, it makes woven fabrics. It's a loom. But it is programmed with punch cards. And this is the first time that the punch card programming happened, at least in the Western world, and became the inspiration for basically all of modern programming languages. You know, the types of punch cards that are used on the loom were direct inspiration to early punch card programming for computers. Whoa.
Stepped away from it.
Your job is to hold down that button for the duration of the talk. That's good. So, you know, punch card programming originated with the jacquard loom. It then moved into sort of more traditional computers, which then informed the design of programming languages, like forevermore, right? So the way that we program computers may be different, right, if people hadn't first figured out how to program a loom to make it so that we can make woven fabrics. So these are some of the reasons why I'm interested in craft and why I'm interested in the intersection between craft and play and computation. In this talk, I'm going to be talking about three specific projects that I've worked on that kind of inhabit some unitless space in the triangle that is formed by play. Textiles in particular, in this space, though I've done a little bit of work with 3D printing as well, and computation. And I'm going to talk about what the projects are and what I feel like I learned through doing these projects. Some of these lessons may be broader lessons that are useful for projects moving forward. Some of them might not be, I'm not really sure yet. But the three projects I'm going to be talking about are eBee, which is a game that is also a quilt, Hoopla, which is computationally generated embroidery patterns, and then Threadsteading, which kind of sits in the middle I'm going to talk about last. Which I feel like is my project that so far has done the best at trying to bridge play, computation, and textile arts. To me, all of these projects are sort of infused with this idea of questioning gender in the spaces that they're intended for, right? Whether it's juxtaposing embroidery and computation as a way of saying, like, what is the relationship between this very gendered act of doing embroidery and this very gendered computation, or like the gendering of play spaces and the gendering of quilts, right? So that it's not on the triangle because it kind of like sits above all of the projects and kind of just is a theme I care about. So let's get started talking about the game. So this is eBee. I get to brag a little bit. I try not to do this too much, but eBee is a game that's also a quilt. We were very fortunate to be able to take it to the Boston Festival of Indie Games last year, where it won the Most Innovative Tabletop Game Award. So let me explain first how eBee works, and then talk a little bit about our design motivations and what we feel like we learned from making this game. So eBee is a game that is also a quilt. In eBee, you are playing with quilted patches. I wish, in retrospect, I'd brought them with me because, like, it's a cool demo. But so you're playing with quilted patches that are hexagonal. There are patches that are islands that have LEDs on them. There's a central patch in the middle of the board that has the battery in it, and then there's colored patches in this version that are purple and green. That have channels of conductive fabric on them that are making little paths. And your goal in eBee is to build circuits that connect from the hub, which is the light blue patch on the side. Sorry, hold on.
The hub is the dark blue one, and you're trying to build from the positive end of the battery on the hub to LEDs that are on the island patches, and then back through to the hub again to complete a circuit. So basically, the purple and green patches, you can think of them as wire, right? You've got a battery and you've got LEDs, and your goal is to light things up. eBee is a game that's played in teams, and it can be played in teams either in a collaborative or cooperative mode, where in the cooperative mode, you're working together to see how many LEDs on the board you can light up with the patches that have been made available to you. Collaborative and cooperative. That should be competitive and cooperative. In the competitive mode, you're working together, you're competing with each other to see who can get as many lights as possible lit up, right? And when they light up, they look like this. And there's like little LEDs on each of these. There's three LEDs per light blue patch, and you're lighting up the LED that's closest to the patch that you put down. So eBee is an interesting game when we show it to people because people tend to like it for different reasons. Some people like it because they're into quilts, some people like it because they're into games, some people are just like super into the idea that they can play a board game with lights on it. It really depends on age range and background of who's playing it. And that was intentional in our design of the game. So when we were creating eBee, we followed both a value-driven design process and an affordance-driven design process. Where on the value-driven design side, we really wanted to bring in some of the elements of quilting that were most powerful to us and most meaningful to us, and sort of most interesting and like different from what we typically see in games, and try to bring them into the game process. So we really wanted to highlight the social nature of quilting, right? eBee is named for the idea of quilting bees, or sewing bees, where many, typically women, will get together in one space and work on their own patches, and then bring it together to form a completed quilt, right? So in the same way, you can kind of consider eBee as you're designing a quilt while you're playing with these hexagonal patches. And actually, in an early version of the game, we were thinking that what would happen is people would sew them together as they were playing, so at the end of the game, there would be like a final physical artifact. But it turns out that like the set of people who know how to sew and want to play games and are willing to sit down for like hours on end to do it is really small. So we moved back to Velcro. We wanted to highlight the collaborative nature of quilting, which is why even in the competitive version of the game, you're still playing on a team with someone else, right? So it's a four-player game with two teams of two, and you're competing. So you've still got some level of collaboration that's happening even in the competitive mode. We really wanted to highlight the creative aspect of quilting, right? The idea that you're trying to build something and making aesthetically motivated choices. And in the collaborative mode, where people are trying to light up as many lights as possible, we actually see things happen where people will say, like, I could reach this LED with these patches, but it makes a really ugly design, right? And so I'm willing to trade off the fact that we won't get that LED for the sake of being able to have, like, a nice alternating pattern with the patches. So that's something we were really happy to see and something we were trying to design for, where we wanted to get people to confront, like, the aesthetic quality of what they were building, and trading it off against the strategy that they would need to follow to succeed. And we wanted to highlight the intergenerational nature of quilting, the fact that often it's a craft that's passed down, especially between women. And this is something that we see in the gameplay, where oftentimes people who so we've shown eBee in a variety of settings. The Boston Festival of Indie Games is like mostly gamers show up, it's a lot of men show up to play. They were like, my mom quilts, right? Like, she would like this. But we've also shown it at the Indie Arcade at the Smithsonian American Museum of Art, which brings in a much more, an audience much more from the general public. And there we would really see, you know, like older women sit down with like their grandkids, right, and play. And it was really sweet actually that we could start to see like, oh, you know, grandma makes quilts, right, Nana makes quilts, be able to have a conversation about their lives and their practices while playing a game. So that was the value-driven design aspect of making eBee. We also came at this design process from an affordance-driven design perspective, where we wanted to really take the materials that we had and that was an awesome cell phone ring, by the way. We really wanted to take the materials that we had and kind of play with them and see what came out from playing with them, right? In the same way that you might do sort of exploratory sculpture with clay, right? And you talk about like the material speaking to you. We wanted to do the same thing with eBee. Like, what do these materials tell us that we can do? And maybe the most obvious is that we wanted to make a game that feels like a quilt, right? Like, it feels really tactile, and that drove the design of the pieces quite a lot. It was making sure that they felt sort of thick like a quilt and like warm, right? Like, there was a feeling of warmth to them when you hold them and touch them and play with them, and like, it feels nice to move them around. The affordance-driven design process that we followed also meant that we ended up settling on a fairly simple mechanic, like just building circuits, just like connecting positive to negative, like in a circuit. We actually started out with this like crazy computational idea where like it was going to be like an AI-based game with like the lily pad Arduino would be driving the board, and then you would be like putting patches down and effects would happen way over on the other side. But the materials didn't let us do that. Like, there's a lot of complexity there that it wasn't clear how to make it work with the lily pad Arduino as it is. But just, it didn't feel, and this is the super unscientific side of me, right? But like, it didn't feel right when we were doing this. And the materials, especially being able to work with conductive fabric, felt like we were meant to like cut it up into little bits and kind of see what happens, right? That's what you do with quilting. We borrowed motifs from the act of quilting and put them into the game. So it's not a coincidence that the game is played on a hex grid, right? Because hex grids are common in games, but hex grids are also very common in quilting. And there's a tradition of making hexagonal pieces and piecing them together and making quilts, and so we borrowed heavily from that. We also, with this project, had a goal of trying to bridge crafting and making communities. So this project actually started out, we didn't intend to design a game when we started this project, which in retrospect seems very silly. We started out thinking that we were going to be making workshops, where we wanted to be able to bring older women and like younger men and kids into one space, and it was like, what's a cool project we could do that really speaks to these communities and tries to bridge crafting and making communities? And we had this vision of, you know, a sewing machine sitting next to a soldering iron, right? Like, this is a space where people can learn and do interesting things. And as we were trying to figure out what the workshop would look like, we started to realize we were making a game. And I was like, okay, let's make the game, right? And maybe next year we'll go back to the workshop idea. But it means that we came in with this goal of bridging crafting and making through making the game. And the game really takes advantage of fabrication technologies, right? So all of the pieces for the game are laser cut. This is especially important with the conductive fabric pieces, which need to be like designed and cut in a certain way so you're not like short-circuiting yourself as you play the game, which is terrible. And cutting these out by hand would just be like a nightmare, so we laser cut them. But it also means that all of the hexagons can be laser cut, right? And we try to avoid human error. So that we can have like nice, precise-sized pieces that you can play a game with. There's still some error here and there, but it's soft fabric, so it doesn't really matter. And obviously, we're borrowing from work in soft circuits, so we're using lily pad Arduino components. Now, really, just the battery holders and the LEDs, but we started out with this whole thing, right? But then we're also using traditional quilting techniques to make the game, so the hexagonal pieces are quilted using a traditional technique from quilting called quilt-as-you-go hexagons, so that each one is actually like its own, each patch is its own like self-contained quilt. And we're using a combination of hand and machine sewing to be able to make the game. So a couple accidents like happened along the way, which I thought were interesting. One I already mentioned, this idea that we started out thinking we were going to make a workshop, and then we accidentally made an award-winning board game. I recommend having these accidents in your career on a regular basis. The other thing is we didn't really realize going into it that we were making an educational game. But then as we started playing, and especially started playing with a lot of kids, we realized that we were teaching how circuits work in order to be able to teach kids how to play the game. And then they were like totally getting it and starting to say, well, you know, now that, you know, this LED has power, does that mean that, like, I can chain off of it and, like, build another circuit from here? And, like, they started to actually understand the rudimentary ideas underlying circuits, which means that we now get to move forward with talking about, you know, can we get funding for this as an educational game? Can we work with local museums? So it's really been an exciting project from that perspective as well, but we did not set out thinking we were going to make an educational board game. So a few general, I like triangles a lot, I like hexagons a lot. A few generals of lessons that we learned from making eBee before I move on to the next project, is we felt like we were constantly trying to navigate this tension, right, between making something that feels like a nice game, making something that's sort of authentic and speaks to quilting in a meaningful way, and like using soft circuits in a reasonable way that is not like horribly complex, but is not like depressingly simple. And so we felt like we were trying to always negotiate this tension, right? And I feel like some of the things that we did really well here is we managed to harness the social nature of both quilting and games, right? And it's a board game that people talk while they're playing, and it plays just slow enough that the sort of conversation that's happening outside of just game strategy, which is really nice, was sort of merging quilting and circuits, and that we're really trying to highlight like the tangible, tactile nature of play and encourage people to really play with the patches in a meaningful way. And then we're kind of bridging games and soft circuits by harnessing the fact that these are very like require rigid systems thinking to be able to play. But then there's also these sort of tensions on the outside of the triangle that we're constantly trying to navigate, right? Like quilting is a very slow process. Like it takes months, if not years, to make a quilt. But most people don't want to take months, if not years, to play a simple board game. So games tend towards very fast play, and we're constantly trying to figure out like where on the spectrum do we want to fall with this. Quilting is reasonably forgiving as a craft. Like fabric is soft and often stretchy, and you can kind of like you can ease mistakes out. Whereas there is no room for error with circuits, right? Like either you've made the connection or you haven't made the connection. That light is going to be on or off, right? And so we were constantly trying to sort of figure out how to make something that speaks to both of those. And similarly, games, we wanted to have something that feels really playful and feels really emergent. But circuits don't feel playful in the same way. Like, you have to follow very strict rules. So we started out with ideas for patches where, like, there would be a bunch of, like, wires that are crossed, basically. Like, all six sides of a patch would have a connection in and out of it. Like, that is a nightmare from a circuit design perspective. Even with the game that we've got now, sometimes people will find bugs in it, and we're sitting down like drawing circuit diagrams, trying to figure out like why is that LED brighter than this one, and like why is that LED not turning on. So trying to sit sort of in the middle of that space is an interesting design challenge. But I think there's room to make a whole lot more games than just eBee that sit in this space, right, obviously. But I think these are some of, if you're interested in doing this yourself, these are some of the tensions that you're going to run up against when you try to do it. So that's eBee. Let's, like, come up from eBee and dive down into another project. So I'm going to talk briefly about the Hoopla project. Which was commissioned by Science Gallery Dublin and is currently installed there for the next couple months as part of their Humans Need Not Apply art exhibit, where they've got a bunch of like AI-created artworks hanging out, and Hoopla is one of them. So Hoopla is a generated embroidery project where I was trying to explore the tension between human authorship and computer authorship in a physical space. So Hoopla creates a bunch of cross-stitch patterns, cross-stitch sampler patterns, And these are sort of digital renderings of what they would look like, which then, so far, just I stitch into like actual physical finished pieces. So I can only blame myself because I wrote the software as well when it has me do something like super complicated and really time consuming. But the idea behind Hoopla is that it's trying to create things that look believably like traditional cross-stitch samplers, but with a digital aesthetic to them. So Hoopla works by pulling quotes from online sources. So in this example, I assume the quote that it pulled, though I don't actually know. I can only like infer from looking at the finished pieces. I assume it was someday my prints will come, right? Because like someday is there and prints is there and something's going on in that top one as well. So it pulls down quotes from an online source, uses a selected keyword from that quote to search another online source to find a color palette that matches that keyword, that someone out in the world, bless them, has like tagged the color palette with a word. Whoever is in the source that I'm using really likes blue, because like the blue palettes have a lot more tags on them than the non-blue ones. It builds up a keyword set by doing this iteratively and then generates collections of embroidery that I then stitch painstakingly by hand into finished pieces that look like this. It takes a long time to do this, for the record. So with Hoopla, this is obviously a very different kind of project from eBee, right? For one, it's like not a game, though it still feels playful in the way that craft feels playful to me. But this is really more a project that is about looking at the intersection between craft and computation. And actually the process of stitching these pieces, which took me, weeks. And I was pulling like 5-6 hour shifts at night. I watched a lot of TV while I was doing this. I made it like all the way through Angel and halfway through Bones. Like, it was great. I'm still catching up on my TV. But it really got me reflecting a lot on like what is the relationship between craft and computation as I'm like painstakingly rendering pixel by pixel the image that like took milliseconds to render on my machine. So craft is something that is very algorithmic, right? Especially knitting and embroidery crafts. Like, you as the human executing that craft are really following a computer program. This becomes very clear in knitting patterns. How many people in this room knit? Yeah, the language that you guys follow when you do that with the abbreviations, like you're following a programming language. It's got control flow, it's got loops, it's got variables. Like, it is a programming language, right? And you, as the person doing the knitting, are executing that programming language. Like, you're your own little like knitting CPU, right? So I'm fascinated by this relationship between craft and computation, where they're both very algorithmic processes, right? Except that when humans do it, there's room for error and there's room for flexibility, and we call that interesting. We don't call it a bug. Craft is, especially pixel-based crafts like cross-stitch, are really following a rendering process in the same way that like your graphics card is following a rendering process, right? It's just a lot slower. The languages that we use to describe crafts, especially needle crafts, are often very symbolic, and they're often very formal as well, right? Like knitting languages, and like cross-stitch patterns, which are like have little codes in them for saying like what pixel is what and what stitch type should you use where. Like, this is a formal language, right? Like a formal specification language. And I think increasingly people are kind of on board with this idea that craft has a relationship to computation in this way. What I found interesting on this project was also thinking about computation and programming as a craft. And by that, I don't necessarily mean like honing your craft to be a better software engineer, right? More like there is an aesthetic to programming and an amount of labor that goes into it that can be easily ignored and forgotten because it's digital, right? And we don't like, I mean, like, you'll get repetitive stress injuries, but like you don't feel in your bones, right, that you've had a hard day at the programming mines, right? Like, it's been real, like, I was up for hours, right? Like, maybe a little bit. But it really highlighted to me how labor-intensive, like, looking at some of the things that are common in craft that was then common in my process for creating Hoopla, sort of how labor intensive it is and how much a labor of love it was to try to get the system to create designs that were interesting and meaningful to me. I found myself, while programming Hoopla, making very aesthetically oriented decisions. So the overlays that are happening in this image, so the orange lines that are intersecting the blue diagonals, and kind of the gaps that are in some of the blue diagonals above the quote, and then at the very top, actually, the word self is like superimposed on top of the alphabet. Those weren't supposed to happen, right? Those are bugs. And typically we would say like, oh God, it's a bug, I should fix it. And I actually went into designing Hoopla with this very software engineering mindset, right? Of like, what is an embroidery sampler? Well, it's subdivided spaces. So I'm gonna have like a recursive subdividing algorithm that's gonna like figure this out. But I found myself finding these bugs and not really wanting to fix them, but also not really wanting to try to re-engineer them to not be bugs anymore, right? Because I was worried that it would take them away. And so I found myself really, what I think like people in the software engineering world would be just like, no, that Gillian, that's just bad software engineering, right? But like, I found myself really trying to embrace that, right, as part of my craft. And like, the code is a mess, and I promise this isn't just an excuse for how messy the code is. Like, it really, like, it was really important to me that I keep those elements to it, and have that as part of my craft. I started to think, you know, in the process of stitching these patterns, it gives you a lot of time to be very reflective, right, on what you're doing. And I found myself wishing that there's time for the level of reflection that you can do when you're like stitching pixel by pixel. Wishing that there was time for that level of reflection during the programming process, right? Where there's like, it's almost like mandated downtime, right? When you're stitching, like it's gonna take me 10 minutes to finish this row, right? And during that 10 minutes, I know exactly what I've gotta do. I've just gotta keep doing this repetitive motion, and it gives me a lot of time to think. And in programming, there isn't that built-in time to think as part of the craft, because typing is fast, and we pride ourselves on being fast typers. And like, if we can't figure out how to do something, we can go search Stack Overflow and figure out how to do it, and like, and build it in. And we pride ourselves on it being a fast thing that we can do. And I find myself really deeply wishing for it to be slower, right? And for me to have the time to be able to reflect on programming as my craft while I was doing it. And then I also think there's an interesting shared authorship problem that comes in here. And I'm like, this is kind of like the bullet that doesn't quite fit in computationist craft. But the idea that I wrote this software and I stitched these pieces, so in many ways this should be my piece, but there is no way that on my own I would have come up with these designs, right? So I feel like I need to attribute part of the authorship of this design to the software I wrote, which feels really weird. And this is a thing that comes in with a lot of computational art. I'm certainly not the first person to confront this idea that like my software deserves authorship credit. Like Harold Cohen notably thinks about this a lot, thought about this a lot as well. But I thought it was certainly something that occurred to me again as I was putting together this talk around like who really takes responsibility for what I created. Obviously I do, because like the buck stops with me as the human, and I have the ability to like think critically about what I've made in ways that the software does not. But the software certainly is doing things that are unexpected and interesting to me, and that drive why people tend to look at these patterns and think they're interesting. Right? I can't take full credit for that myself. This project got me thinking a lot about generative design in general. So my background in my PhD was in procedural content generation for games, where you know I was trying to generate Mario-style levels and have algorithms that can create Mario-style levels or Sonic-style levels. But it got me thinking a lot about how when we build software, we're building formal theories of design, right? And I spent a lot of time trying to like bash my head against this idea of like, what does it mean to be an embroidery sampler? Like on the level that I can program the computer to make one for me. So I thought that was an interesting piece as well. I'm deliberately moving a little bit faster through these because I want to make sure there's time to talk about thread setting at the end. Sorry. The other thing that I'm enjoying with Hoopla right now is that as part of it being at Science Gallery Dublin, the people there who are just delightful said, you know, we want to have, you know, it's great that you've made these embroideries, Gillian, right? But we want to have an interactive element in our exhibit. Can you make this software available to people in the gallery? And then we'll provide the materials for them to be able to make their own. And I was like, okay, well, so embroidery is really hard to teach just, like, off the bat. And I don't want to give them, like, 22-count canvas and all the colors, right, and, like, figure out this. So I spent some time trying to, like, noodle on what would be a good way to make this public-facing and interactive. And I came down to, like, a constrained color palette of threads and, like, a 3x3 square piece of plastic canvas that you can do cross-stitching with a really big needle that isn't sharp, so no one's going to hopefully hurt themselves, and that, like, it was the easiest way I could think of to get people doing embroidery. And then they set up this website where you can see what patterns people are choosing to save and print with the intent of making it for themselves. So it gives me this ability to take this massive space of potential designs that the system is making and be able to see, like, what do individuals find compelling enough to save off? So these are two examples, one above that second bullet point and one below. Two examples of pieces that people in the gallery have decided are interesting enough to save off. And it also, I think, forces people to confront the fact that generated art is ephemeral. And what I see when, sort of informally, when people are playing with the system as well is that people say, like, I really like this one. And if I hit the generate button, I'll never see it again. Right? Like, I know it's not going to come back. There's maybe something similar to it, but, like, it's never going to be exactly this again. But I'm not sure if I like it enough to make it, right? And there isn't a save feature. Like, there isn't a way to, like, undo a decision that's been made. It's just like, nope, you're going to keep going, right? Like, you need to decide if this is going to be it or not. And it's been a really interesting sort of experiment, in quotes, because it's not a scientific one yet, of looking at how do people want to engage with generated art and what is considered worthy of saving. And what does it mean for some of it to just never be seen again? Like, it's generated, but never saved, never stored. All right, so that's the Hoopla project. I want to close with talking briefly. What time is it? OK, I've got a little bit of time, right?
Yes.
OK. I want to close with talking briefly about the Threadsteading project. So Threadsteading is maybe my weirdest project that gets an alternated response of either, like, that's so cool, or that's so weird, or, like, maybe both. Threadsteading is a game that's played on embroidery machines. We took it to IndieCade last year, where it won the Technology Award, which we're all really happy about. So let me tell you a little bit about how it works, and then how and why we designed it, and why I think it's interesting, maybe beyond just the novelty factor of, like, a game that you play on an embroidery machine. So Threadsteading was actually originally designed for a long-arm quilting machine. A long-arm quilting machine is the width of a king-size quilt, right? So it's about 10 feet wide, and it has a sewing bed that's about 3 feet deep. This is a needle on a long-arm quilting machine. The needle can move freely over the quilt surface. So on traditional sewing machines and embroidery machines, you move the canvas under a fixed needle. On a quilting machine, you move the needle over a fixed canvas. And it actually feels like driving. It's, like, really cool to use it. And I was visiting the Disney Research Pittsburgh Textiles Lab, where they have one of these big quilting machines. They also have a loom and a knitting machine. And we were trying to think about, like, what does it mean to gain interactive control over these systems? Like, we know they're programmable, right? There's a computer in it somewhere. But right now, the only way that we can interface with it is through this terrible software that's, like, made by people who don't really understand quilting, right? Because, like, the intersection of people who can, like, do software engineering and make quilts and have good HCI and UX skills is really low. And they're probably not working for the embroidery and sewing machine companies. So, you know, what does it mean to bypass that software and be able to get interactive control over these machines? And what would be a good way to demo this? And we're like, well, games have historically been used to demo new technologies. This is a pretty old technology, but the thing that we're, like, reverse engineering would be kind of new. So let's make a game for it, right? So we made a game for a quilting machine. Threadsteading is a two-player territorial control game. that stitches the paths that you're choosing to take on the map as you move around the space. And then the winner takes the map home with them. So the machine is kind of stitching a play trace of the game as you go through. So we made this game for a quilting machine. By the end of the process where we made it, we realized we made a really cool thing that we wanted to show people, and then realized that there is no way that we can possibly like move this 10-foot by 3-foot quilting machine anywhere. And it's like hyper specific to that specific motherboard and that specific machine, right? Because we needed to like figure out the communication protocol that that one machine uses. So we can't just like rent someone else's machine in some space somewhere and like hope they don't mind us taking apart the CPU and like futzing with it. So we needed to port it to something more portable. So we ported it to an embroidery machine. This is a consumer-grade embroidery machine that's about the size of a typical embroidery machine. It would easily fit on this podium, right? Like, maybe like this much of the podium would be taken up with it. And this is what the game looks like when you come up to it. So we replaced the panel on the front of the machine with our own custom-made panel that's, like, laser-cut acrylic and then, like, a thing underneath it. And like put a little LED so you can see whose move it is right now. And this is a hexagonal pattern. Again, this is a game that's played on a hex grid, right? It's not coincidental. And the player can push one of the 6 buttons on this panel to decide which direction their player is going to move on the map. The machine will then stitch the path that they've taken through this grid. The grid is... like each space is weighted by how many points it costs to move into that space, and you've got a limited number of movement points per turn, so you're like trying to trade off how far you can go versus how much territory you can gain. And then wherever that player stops, the next player picks up and starts and moves out in another direction. The story right behind the game is that you're competing rival scout commanders in a scouting party where you're supposed to make it look like you're cooperating with each other and moving around the same space, but you get to take turns deciding which direction you're going to go that day, and you're trying to like get credit for the cool spaces on the map. Right, so you're trying to maximize the amount of space you get, minimize the amount of space the other person gets, get good coverage across the entire map. I think one of the important parts of this game is that because it's played fully on the machine, and the machine like takes the place of the screen, there is no running score that's happening that you can see. Right, because that would require like a separate rendering process, right, to be able to update the score on each turn, which we don't have. So we stitch the score at the end of the game, and so you're constantly trying to figure out like what's my score right now relative to you, but you don't ever really know unless you're being like super picky about it, and it's really hard to keep track. So there's like an interesting tension that comes from that. So this was a game where we again followed this sort of affordance-driven design process, right? Where here where slow play is mandated upon us, right? We can't have the machine stitch faster than it can stitch, right? Like that is our like we have no control over this whatsoever. We have it stitch as fast as it can, but like it still takes maybe a minute to complete a move, and so it gives us time to be able to have this sort of deep strategic thinking, because there's a move timer built in, right? Like you need to think about what you're going to do next while the machine is stitching, and then because it takes so long to stitch, there's this social pressure around making sure you pick your move quickly, because if I wait another 2 minutes to stitch and then there's going to think about what I'll do and then there's like another 2 minutes while it's stitching the move, like there's a lot of social pressure around picking your move as soon as the last move has finished stitching. The unknown score, as I said, kind of plays into the feeling of the game. And then from a machine perspective, there's a couple things that we needed to build into the design of the game. So you're not allowed to sew back, or we try to limit sewing back over spaces that you've already sewn. Because if an embroidery machine stitches over the same place many, many times, it can get really knotted underneath, right? And like your tension goes wonky and it's bad, like the machine will break on you. And also the structural integrity of the fabric is damaged, right, because a needle is sticking down through it a lot of times. So we want to design the game to limit that. And we need to follow a single unbroken line during play. You can't, like, have the needle jump way over to another part, because again, that's going to cause a lot of problems with the machine. So these are some of the affordances of the machine that went into the design of the game. And again, we cared about the medium, right, and making sure that we were really respecting the original medium of quilting, but then it translated quite nicely down into the embroidery machine as well. Where in quilting, your goal is to have an even density of stitches over the entire quilt. It's what makes it so that some areas don't pucker up and sort of loosen up over time. So we designed the game to try to encourage even exploration across an entire map. We again borrowed this hexagon motif from quilting, and we wanted to capture this idea of storytelling in quilting, where quilts are often made to tell specific stories or for specific events, like baby quilts and wedding quilts. We wanted to have an artifact that could tell the story of play, right? And it's believable that after you finish playing, you can look at this finished piece and be able to see like what happened and who made what decision when. The final thing that I wanted to talk about with Threadsteading is the intersection of gender and computing. And this is something that really came home to me when we showed the game at IndieCade, where we hadn't really, we thought it was kind of cool and interesting that, like, we were programming a sewing machine, right? Like, that's unusual. It's showing computing in unexpected locations. And we knew that we were, like, doing something with automating and, like, gaming a, like, highly gendered activity. And, like, the idea of making software for quilting is something that's unexpected to a lot of people. But when we were showing the game at IndieCade, it was on the third day and I was exhausted and my voice was gone. Like, everything, I was getting really sick, right? Like, I hadn't slept. We were all tired. I have, like, a young child at home, so I'm, like, managing the fact that, like, I need to go pump every so often. Like, it's just, like, this hectic nightmare. And this little girl comes up to the table. And it's like, oh, you're welcome to Threadsteading. Threadsteading is a game for, like, 2D territorial control game for sewing machines. And the little girl's like, all right, tell me how it works. We're like, well, you know, there's this button panel on the side of the machine, and you press the buttons, and it'll tell the needle where to go. And she's like, no, I get that. Tell me how it works. We're like, well, this is an embroidery machine, and embroidery machines have computers in them. She's like, okay, yeah, but tell me how it works. And she kept asking and, like, drilling deeper and deeper down until finally we're like, all right, well, you can see in the back of the machine, and we've had to, like, remove all of the guts of the embroidery machine. Like, they're spread across the table behind it, right? Because there's no space for, like, the stuff that we hooked in. And I point to this little, like, green circuit board, and it's like, well, so this is called a Raspberry Pi, and it's a computer, and we programmed it to make the game work. And her eyes went so wide, and she's like, my dad has one of those. And then she turns and looks at her mom, and her mom is, like, looking terrified at this point. And she points to the machine, and she points to her mom, and she says, my mom has one of these. And then she turns to her mom and says, mommy, can we go home and make one? And, like, I don't know, like, we won an award, whatever, but, like, we won IndieCade with that moment, right? With this moment of this little girl suddenly realizing that these two worlds that her parents have as hobbies were colliding. And that she was seeing a way that computing was, like, relevant and interesting to her in a place that she didn't realize it was. And, you know, yeah, it's cool. We made a game for embroidery machines. Like, yeah, that's awesome, right? But we made that little girl realize what computing could be and what it could mean to her. And that means even more to me. So I know I'm running short on time. This is the bit where I wrap up, right? So I've talked about several projects kind of at the intersection of craft and computation and play. Anne Sullivan, who's a professor at UCF, and myself actually ran a workshop on this. We're hoping to maybe get together with Josh and Karen and run another one at some point, where we're kind of looking at making new kinds of games. This is an interactive storytelling game using scrapbooking material that's copying the IF authoring tool called Twine. So this is like for those of you who know Twine, this is like a physical version of Twine for telling interesting stories. And I think the main things that I wanted to highlight to you that are interesting to me is I think bridging craft and computation and play lets us find new audiences, find people who are interested in games, show people the interesting areas of computing that they may not have thought of before. But also broaden the horizons of traditional audiences, right? So, like, at IndieCade, we met a lot of very traditional indie gamers, right, who were like, a sewing machine? Oh, my God, right? And it shows, like, this area of play to people who may not think about it. It lets us look at how we can adopt new technologies to make new kinds of games, right? But at the same time, really try to deeply respect old technologies that have been here for a long time that we shouldn't forget. So with that, thank you very much for listening to my talk. I would be remiss in not acknowledging the many people who I work with on these various projects and the people who have been generous enough to give us money to be able to do them. And thank you.
All right, I think we have time for a few questions before
okay.
we head down.
Yeah.
So.
Yes.
The knitting patterns that you made that were generated, have you ever thought about making a Twitter bot? And, like, do you follow that community?
So there is, so there's a Twitter bot that isn't hooked up to it right now, right? So yeah, I have a bot and I have some software, and at some point I really need to figure out how to make them talk to each other so it works. But yes,
I am. Sorry, have you ever used cheap bots done quick?
I have the, and actually the language behind that tracery, Kate Compton is at Santa Cruz, and I love her. I can't figure out how to, like, I don't want to figure out how to port my code to work with tracery, right?
Yes,
I just need to, like, have, there's some, like, technical thing that I need to figure out how to do, and then it will totally be an embroidery, there'll be an embroidery Twitter bot one day, I promise, but it may take me, like, maybe it'll be a summer project, I don't know. Yeah, Aaron.
Yeah, thanks for the wonderful presentation. You know, I've been following your stuff for a while. So I'm wondering if you could talk more about if there have been any other success cases or maybe failure cases in the sort of project of collapsing gender with these masculine aspects and these feminine aspects. And, like, you give us an amazing example of this little girl who saw it in an amazingly positive space. Have there been other examples of that or...
like with other projects, or
folks who have been really inspired by your work, or maybe folks who have been really critical of it.
That's a good question, Aaron. I feel like a lot of it's tough to get a good integration of like things that are seen as being interesting to women and computation and games. Without, like, you risk making, like, Barbie fashion designer all over again, right? Just, like, making something that's pink. I was like, oh, girls like fashion, so they must like games about fashion, right? And so I think we weren't, I'm not sure if this is answering the question, but we deliberately went into this project not trying to make it, like, a game for girls, right? Or not trying to make it something that would showcase the beauty of computing to women, right? Like, that we didn't want to engage with it consciously on that level, which I think in part is part of why I think people have overall responded positively about Threadsteading, at least to my face, right? Like, maybe people are, like, off in some corner, like, critiquing it, and it there are valid critiques to be made. But I think this is kind of the same way that eBee is, like, accidentally an educational game, right? Like, we didn't set out wanting to teach people about circuits. With Threadsteading, we didn't set out wanting to, like, reach 8-year-old girls and show them how, like, their parents' hobbies can be combined, right? We set out with sort of, we had quilting expertise on the team, we had game design expertise on the team, we had, like, figuring out how to reverse engineer old software, like, old hardware systems expertise on the team, and, like, it kind of grew from that organically. So that's what we were trying to do there. I don't know if that answers your question.
I appreciate the thoughts. So.
I think it didn't, but we can talk about it later. Yeah.
That was a really interesting talk. I'm really interested in the idea of what's happening to, like, the game board or the embroidery after it's finished. Whether you had any ideas about that.
So I think that is actually one of the critiques of the game that I've heard that I agree with, right, where it's like, well, you've got a game board at the end, but, like, does anyone really care about it? It's interesting because people will talk about, like, oh, I definitely want to win this physical thing, right? It's like, it's a motivation for them during play. Like, I'm definitely going to take this thing home with me, right? It's like a real reward, right? It's somehow more meaningful to them than, like, 1,000 points or whatever because, like, they get a physical thing at the end. But I haven't really seen anyone do anything with it afterwards. And I would fully expect that most of them get thrown away, right? Because it's not really clear what you would want to do with it and why it exists as a physical thing, and it feels wasteful to me in some ways. But in some ways, in the same way that like craft can often feel wasteful, right? We're like, oh god, I've got so many quilts in my house that I've made, and the process of making them was great, but like, what am I really gonna do with them? Like, no one needs as many quilts as I have.
Yeah, I wasn't like, that's a really good point. I wasn't even critiquing in my head. I was like, you can make it into a T-shirt so they can wear it.
You could, yeah. I've thought about like taking a bunch of plays of threadsteading and like sewing them into a quilt and like making the threadsteading quilt. Like, I feel like that would be a cool thing to have. But then again, it's like another quilt in my house. I don't need that many. Yeah, Josh.
I turned threadsteading into a pocket square.
Did you? Oh, that's right.
And
I remember
that.
It's
now in my pocket square collection.
Excellent.
And it matches everything.
It's got lots of colors. All the colors.
Do we want to head downstairs
yeah.
for our wine and cheese?
Yes, we do.
So,
and I do.
As is our tradition in this department, we'll save any questions you have for Gillian until we're all downstairs. We have wine and cheese and snacks. I will take Gillian downstairs and she will jump the line so that she can get some food before she has a chance to talk with you. But thank you again for coming out, and thank you, Gillian.